I was invited to a conference where the old chemical industry, which had now started to buy up small biotechnology firms, were talking about how they wanted to genetically engineer every seed. And the reason they wanted to genetically engineer every seed was so they could patent it. Because by adding new genes, they could say, I've created a novel life form. And to achieve this, they were working on an international free trade treaty, which then used to be called the Uruguay Round of GATT and became the World Trade Organization. And the treaty is the Trade-Related Intellectual Property Rights Agreement, which in effect gave corporations like Monsanto the right to enter any country and start taking ownership on the biodiversity, both through genetic engineering, but as we saw in a case that I fought of a biopiracy of wheat from India, Monsanto started to just grab what they could, including old varieties, and claim it as theirs. And as our recent report, both from us on the basis of the more than 3,000 rices that we have saved in Navdanya, which means 9 seeds, and it also means the new gift, we have saved seeds of salt-tolerant varieties, of flood-tolerant varieties, of salt-tolerant variety, of drought-tolerant varieties, and these are all now being patented by Monsanto, etc. Released a report at Nagoya on the biopiracy of climate-resilient genes, and they now have 1,600 biopiracy in the list. When and Monsanto went on record after the WTO was formed to say that in writing this treaty, we have been the patient, the diagnostician, and the physician all in one. We defined a problem, and the problem was that farmers save seeds. And we offered a solution that it should become illegal for farmers to save seeds. And that's why the whole intellectual property idea that once a seed is an intellectual property of a company, then a farmer saving seed is treated as a thief. We, who'd been protecting biodiversity, felt that this was wrong, that the problem is to prevent farmers from saving seeds, that that's our duty to protect biodiversity, and that's why I started Navdanya, but we also started with it the campaign, which we call the Seed Satyagraha, the Gandhian concept of not cooperating in unjust law, because we believe patenting of life is totally illegal and immoral. You don't create life, you don't invent life, and therefore a patent, which means a right to an invention, is totally misplaced. And I think the movements we have built over the last few years are starting to make a difference. It was the United States that brought life patenting into the WTO. Recently, in a case related to the breast cancer gene, the United States government has gone on record to say you cannot patent genes because genes exist. You don't create them. And I hope we can take this to the next step and say not just genes, but seeds and all life forms exist or have evolved through nature or through selection, but they haven't been created by the corporations. Now, when genetic engineering was started, I remember in '80s, in the mid-80s, I'd have debates and they'd say how we would never have problems because we'd be growing food on the moon, we'd be growing food in the desert, and we'd be growing food on toxic dumps, because they were going to achieve everything through genetic engineering. What do we have in the year 2010? Only 2 applications that are commercialized on any significant scale. The first of herbicide tolerance, which means a company can spray more herbicides because the seed that they have engineered has resistance to their own herbicide. Everything else gets killed, and you get to sell more chemicals as well as more seeds. The second is a BT, a family of crops where you take a soil organism, pull out the gene for a toxin, put it into the plant, and now the plant produces its own toxin. The first was supposed to reduce weeds or control weeds, and the second was supposed to control pests. Both have failed, and 2009-2010 are the period when the failure rates really became significant. More than 5 million acres in the US are overtaken by herbicide-resistant weeds that can't be controlled by any herbicide. And Monsanto is now giving $6 to $20 per acre to farmers to say, okay, go ahead and use something other than Roundup, because Roundup is failing. Earlier, their contract said you can't use any other chemical. Now they're saying go buy other more lethal chemicals. Among them is the herbicide which was called Agent Orange, which was sprayed in Vietnam. In India, the BT cotton has failed to control the bollworm. New pests have been created. Every year we have a new species of pests which damages the cotton. And 13 times more pesticide use in genetic engineering, even though genetic engineering was offered as an alternative to pesticides. But because the genetic engineering is done largely to own and control the seed, what basically the BT cotton, which was the first crop introduced in India, introduced illegally in 98, we filed a case in the Supreme Court. We stopped Monsanto for 4 years. By then, they'd managed to get their approvals. But originally, they started to take control of the Indian seed companies. And by the time they started to commercially sell the BT cotton, which is this cotton with a toxic gene in it, the prices of cotton seed jumped from 5 rupees a kilo to 3,200 to 3,600 rupees a kilo. Now that's 160,000% increase in seed price. Simultaneously you have an increase in pesticide use, 13-fold, which means 1,300% increase in pesticide. It's introduced into a hybrid, which means you need irrigation, therefore you have more expenses on drilling tube wells or getting water in whichever form you can. The seed is non-renewable compared to the old seed, which was renewable, which you could save from your season to season. So now this excessive cost of 160,000% has to be borne annually by the farmer. And the issue is, people often ask me, now why would the farmers go for this? They go for two reasons. First, the advertisement for the seed, and I've seen this again and again, uses all our sacred texts, all our saints and all our divinities to advertise. And Indian peasants have a deep faith. And they see a Ramayana being played, and they're seeing Hanuman selling cotton seed. They go for it, because they really believe it. If they see Guru Nanak in Punjab, and Guru Nanak, the founder of the Sikh religion, is selling the seed, they go for it. And the second is the claims the company makes. The company had the claim, and the advertisements kept saying this, you will get 1,500 kilograms per acre. The average farmers have had is 300 to 400 with all those additional costs. So the package basically ends up pushing farmers into debt. The same agents of the company who sold the chemicals and the seed basically give credit by saying, you know, just put your thumbprint on your land ownership and you're going to be a millionaire anyway, and the farmer believes it. And in 2 years' time, the farmer can't pay back the debt. The agents of the seed companies come and say, now your land is my land. And that day, the farmer drinks pesticide to end his life.